Welcome to Author's Voice. I'm Daniel Weinberg, and we're sitting in our broadcast studio at the Abraham Lincoln Bookshop on the near north side of Chicago. Sometime you'll join us here, but today it's rainy and cold and awful, and that's why you're sitting on your couch at home, snugly eating a Twinkie and watching our show. First of all, Judith Giesberg, professor of history and director of the graduate program at Villanova University. She's the editor of the Journal of the Civil War Era. This book began as a lecture for the Stephen and Janice Bros lectures in the Civil War era, this series features books based on public lectures delivered each year in the fall, and the intent is to chart new directions for research in the field and offer both scholars and the general public fresh perspectives on the Civil War era, which we could use after all this time. Her book today is Sex and the Civil War, Soldiers, Pornography, and the Making of American Morality. University of North Carolina Press, 135 pages and well illustrated, but no foldouts. We'll show you one a little bit later. And it's $29.95 if you'd like to order it right now or at any time for that matter. Our second author, also from the same university press, is Jonathan White, associate professor of American Studies at Christopher Newport University, a director of the Abraham Lincoln Association and of the Abraham Lincoln Institute, and he's on the advisory council of Ford's Theater. He's writing for the Civil War for America series that interprets broadly the history and culture of the Civil War era through the long 19th century and beyond, drawing on diverse approaches and methods. His book, Midnight in America, Darkness, Sleep, and Dreams During the Civil War. Again, as I said, University of North Carolina Press, we thank them for sending their authors to us constantly. It's 265 pages, illustrated, and $34.95. What made you dream up this book? I had to use it.
Right.
Everyone expected it, but tell me.
I'd like to think it actually came to me in a dream, but that's not what really happened. It was probably about 10 years ago, I was reading Joseph Ellis's Founding Brothers, which is one of my favorite books. And in that book, Ellis traces the relationship between John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. These two men had been very close friends during the Revolution. They fell on opposite sides of the political spectrum by the 1790s. And then in the early 19th century, they renewed their friendship. And the way that happened was Dr. Benjamin Rush of Philadelphia got them to write it to each other. And one of the things Rush convinced them to do was to write about their dreams. And so I was reading this book a number of years ago, and I thought, wouldn't it be really something to write a history of the Civil War through the dreams of people who lived through it? And I started collecting dreams. I thought maybe I could do a narrative history of the war from 1861 to 1865, realized that wouldn't quite work. But I gathered about 400 dreams and put them into different thematic chapters of the people who had different sorts of dreams.
All right. I should mention to all of you watching online that our order button for books has moved to the left of your screen. So you see it right there. So it'll be permanently there from now on. So if you would like to order a book now, you can move your cursor over to that and order a book while you're listening to us as well. I mentioned to each of you before we came on that I have a connection to each of you in your books. And that is my dad was a Freudian psychoanalyst. So dreams were part of my DNA. And I worked for a little over 10 months at the Kinsey Institute, which you use as part of your research Indiana University. And it's on sex research and gender as well. They have an amazing collection, and we'll see something from that you have produced. Not only do they do studies, but they also have wonderful artifacts. Now, it seems to me, I was looking at these two books together, and if you see these two books, it seems to me that there was more dreaming going on than sex. I mean, about double the size. So I was curious as to why that could be. We dream a lot more than we have sex, I presume.
Well, the average person has 5 dreams per night, so it might be hard.
So there you go. Yeah, so there's an arithmetic we're working against here, I guess.
Judy, the purpose of your book is fairly specific but interesting, is to discover the origins of American anti-pornography. Mm-hmm. And could you give us first a brief history of what is pornography?
Sure.
I presume we see it. We know it when we see it.
Yes, yes. Sure. So my interest in this topic started with my discovery of this 1865 measure taken by Congress to prohibit the mailing of erotic materials to the troops because congressmen were concerned that that the Union might actually lose the war if men were distracted by or continue to have access to erotic materials. So they passed this law, which sounded to me very much like post-war Comstock laws that we're all familiar with. So it started with a question about what were the origins of this law, what was the concern, and what exactly were these men reading that got congressmen so agitated and so concerned about the outcome of the war. Now the term
porn... Do you think they're worried about them losing their precious bodily fluids, as Dr. Strangelove said?
Maybe so. Maybe so. The concerns were really more, originating from men who were not in the war, from men who were fighting in the, in the field. There was certainly less concern about, what they were reading or what they were looking at until they became bad soldiers.
Mm-hmm. Now you talk about that. We'll get to a couple of those examples as well. Did this push of pornography, of course, there you have huge amounts of men all alone, but separated, mm-hmm. and on battlefields and in camp. Was there much of a pornography field before the war in America, mm-hmm. or as you're saying, I think in the book, that mm-hmm. Europe contributed mm-hmm. a great deal to this?
Right. One of the most interesting things about working on this book was to discover the timing of all of what all happened sort of simultaneously. So before the war, most of erotica that was available to American readers was imported, right, as you suggested, Dan. And then there were customs laws passed that made it increasingly difficult for that stuff to be imported, which of course then gave birth to, a production of domestic pornography. So erotica dealers were not dissuaded by these customs laws at all. They were, in fact, encouraged to produce their own stuff. And they did. And, of course, there was no copyright of any of this stuff. So a lot of it was just simply copied mm-hmm. from the European models and mass-produced and sold to a wide American audience. And all of this happened within 10 years before the war began. Right, and then when the war comes, you have this sort of fortuitous concentration of men, in urban areas and camps, and you had expedited service, mail delivery service to these men. So it became sort of the perfect, opportune confluence of events for the explosion of domestically produced and consumed erotica.
Did much of this come out of New York, the flash press that you talk about?
So a lot of those, antebellum circulation of the flash press created sort of fertile ground for the printing and circulation of the materials that would then wind up in the camp. Some of this stuff was also seemed to be produced in particular for the particular context of the war. So there were, there were images and some written material that had war-related themes as well. So it was not just sort of reproducing stuff that had been produced before the war mm-hmm. or that had been imported. Some of it really became tailored for the particular circumstances of the Civil War.
Each of you talk about letters, of course, and you don't get a lot of pornography in letters, but you do dreams, it seems, yeah. and that seemed to be the major source for you to find, John, all of this material. And there's so many stories in here of dreams that you found. How did you find them? And tell us about that.
Sure. Well, most of the dreams I found were in letters and diaries. I wanted to avoid post-war dreams for the most part, because if people are having a recollection 30 years later, it may not be as reliable. But if they're writing it down the next morning, then clearly that dream had an impact on what they were thinking about, and so they wanted to communicate it to their loved one at home or write it down in their journal so they'd remember it. And one of the things that really struck me was just how open and honest soldiers and their wives were with each other. Oftentimes they would have really bad dreams, oftentimes bad dreams about each other. And you would think in the Victorian era they would want to keep these things to themselves, but they were very open about sharing them. To sort of, in a related way to the things Judy looked at, one of the most common themes I found in dreams were dreams of infidelity. For soldiers, it often looked like this. They would dream that they went home, they saw their wife on the side of the street, they went up and said hello, and she wouldn't talk to him. But sometimes they were much more intense like that. I found soldiers who dreamt that they went home, their wives were cheating on them with multiple men, and the soldiers, in one dream, a soldier went to commit suicide on a train track. In another dream, he got out his sawed-off shotgun and killed both the men. And then he grabbed a knife, this is all in his dream, and he wrote to his wife, he said, I was about to stab you and myself at the same time with the same knife. And so it's fascinating to see, as they're struggling with very real anxieties, there's also a very real intimacy between them that they feel like they can write about these dreams to each other.
You have a few pages at the end of the book about your methodology, mm-hmm. which I think is worth for everyone reading the book to read first. Mm. You're an historian,
right.
You're not an analyst,
right?
And but I'm going to ask you anyway.
Sure.
Is there some sort of a consensus today about the purpose of dreams? Do you have anything, a couple of a paragraph to say on that?
Well, you made me nervous. At first, I thought you were going to ask me about my dreams, and I didn't want to go there.
I'll have you lie down first.
Right.
Bill you in the morning, by the
right.
way.
I did a little bit of reading in terms of modern scholarship and psychological theories about dreams. Ultimately, I decided I didn't want to use too much psychological theory, on the one hand, because theories change over time. And so as theories change, I didn't want my book to become anachronistic because I clung to a theory that in maybe 20 years is discarded. I didn't put this explicitly in the book, but I sort of consider it a common sense approach to dreams. So I tried to find patterns. What is it that many men are dreaming about? What is it that many women are dreaming about? What does that tell us about their experiences? So Southern women frequently dream of Yankee soldiers coming down into the South and invading. Northern women, by contrast, dream of becoming soldiers and going off to fight. It's a very distinctive dream experience that Northern women and Southern women have. And so in looking at that, I didn't try to get into symbols in dreams. You know, if there was a tree in the dream, what does that mean? Or what do different colors mean? But overall experiences and seeing what they might tell us about different groups in society.
Well, it seems, though, that Victorian times, that dreams were important.
Right.
And I'm wondering if today, if technology is taking that away, would we, for World War II, we didn't have the technology we have now, were their dreams, were soldiers and their loved ones telling of dreams during World War II as much? Today, if we had war, if we had men out there, would they be telling their loved ones dreams in emails and texts? Has
right.
technology taking this away? Is this more a Civil War phenomenon?
It's interesting. I think in the 19th century, dreams were very important to people. And part of that is many Americans believe they might reveal something of the supernatural. So maybe God is giving a sign in terms of something that could happen in the future. So it was quite common for husbands and wives to wake up in the morning in antebellum America and share their dreams with each other. There was a mass marketplace for dream manuals. And these would be guides that would say, well, if you dream about a funeral, that means someone in your life is going to get married. Or if you dream that your tooth gets pulled, that means something good is going to happen to you. And there's all these sorts of manuals. And so I found some people. There was a woman named Ellie Goldwaite, whose husband fought in a New York regiment. And you get the sense that they shared their dreams with each other before the war. And they continued it through correspondence during the war. And so she would write to him and say, I had this dream about you, and I went to check my dream book to see what it meant. She became convinced, for example, that if she dreamt about church, that that meant that her husband would go into battle. So dreams about church, which for most people probably wouldn't be terrifying, were terrifying to her because of how she believed it should be interpreted.
Of course, technology was important to both of you in this, that and I'm seeing that, I first really wanted to ask about, I had a question and now I just lost what I wanted to say, huh? I went on to the next one. That artifacts I mean, I think that's where I want to start out with before. Mm-hmm. That artifacts are important to both of you. Mm-hmm. You had numerous artifacts in prints and commerce, producing all sorts of envelopes and broadsides and prints about dreaming. On the other hand, artifacts there seem to be a dearth of them in your field. Mm-hmm. Yet you say it proliferated everywhere. Mm-hmm. So where do they all go? Mm-hmm. Did they really so ephemeral that they threw them away? They didn't want anyone to know. Mm-hmm. I know you were at the Kinsey Institute and had the Stanhopes that were there and showed. The CDV, of course, was the carte de visite, the albumin photograph. First time on a collodion wet plate, you can start mass producing photographs. And so here I'm showing John Brown, and for a specific reason, just first of all to show you what a carte de visite looks like. But why aren't there more of those available to us today in collections, on the market?
It's a good question. I think part of the answer is that a lot of institutions didn't collect them. And a lot of this, at least a lot of these materials that are still around, are in the hands of private collectors. So it's not a matter of going to the Library of Congress and asking, you know, for their 19th century erotica collection, although I did do that. But there's
a Civil War shows, and there are tons of Civil War shows. I never see it. I don't see books of the era. I don't see the CDVs here and there. There'll be a couple then that come out. But really, there isn't.
Yeah. Well, and that's all. That's because of the after effects of those Comstock laws. And I mean, the reason the Kinsey Institute becomes the home for this material is because that was sort of the safe place where people who were worried about getting in trouble for having the stuff or selling the stuff or showing the stuff sent it to the Kinsey Institute. So the Kinsey Institute is really careful about protecting the people who donated the stuff, the people from whom they bought it until more recently. That was the place where the stuff wound up. And it didn't wind up in private collections.
Is there a lot there on the Civil War?
They have a good amount. They do. They have quite a good amount. They have an incredible collection of carte de visite, and they're not just of individuals who we can identify. They're of actresses, and they're. I think every new photographic technology, that it was tried out. That one of the first things they did was take images of landscapes, exotic landscapes, and then they took pictures of naked women. And they've got, the Kinsey Institute's got every new photographic technology and then, a massive collection of the stuff that was produced for erotic.
You're talking about actresses, and of course, there were a lot of pictures in Godet and various other magazines of women in their dresses, showing off dresses for women. But they seem to have been used also in the field. They were put up there as erotic for them to have a woman there. And do these also show up in dreams? I'm wondering if you could each talk to me about that.
Sure, they do. Soldiers certainly had erotic
dreams.
Actresses,
though?
I never found any of actresses in particular, although I found soldiers who would dream of what we might call fictional women, women who weren't really real, but they would dream that they met a beautiful girl. Actually, in one case, a soldier dreamt that he met a beautiful girl outside of a theater. And in his dream, the woman thought he was an actor, and she said, "Oh, well, my mother said to stay away from actors," so that might be as close as you can get. There's a connection in terms of nocturnal emissions. I found a couple instances of those that I have in the book. And at the time, nocturnal emissions were seen as a disability, and if you had them, it was reason for discharge from the service. And so I found a chaplain in the 145th Pennsylvania who writes in his diary about these men who were having nocturnal emissions and need to be discharged from the service. I found a surgeon from Philadelphia who did research on what they called spermatoria. And he said 3 out of the 4 soldiers they looked at who claimed to have spermatoria had actually produced manufactured evidence of the disorder. So soldiers realized that they could, if they didn't want to be in the service, they could try to get out of it that way.
Well, I'm just going to read something very quickly here. I wish I had the document here, the letter here, but I don't. It's gone now. But it was in 59, and Admiral Foote actually was on this, signing this as well. But it was a medical discharge of a soldier who had a tumescence and a growth a swelling that wouldn't go away. And so he was discharged. He went to another hospital. Two surgeons saw him there. Two medical people saw him there. And one of them certifies that he was afflicted with mania because of this tumescence, and explained that he has a derangement of the liver with the tumescence, a swelling. Then in the postscript, it's added that he was addicted to masturbation. Mm-hmm. So that was the cause of his mania. And after 4 hours, it wouldn't go down. He went to a doctor, right?
Right.
So was this common in the war, that not only nocturnally, but manually, masturbation was just only one use of it in your book. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, is this not something that happens in the field quite a bit?
Well, there's certainly people who wind up in institutions, you know, hospitals and others, homes, in the aftermath of, you know, of their war experience, suffering from, you know, who are diagnosed with sort of problems with masturbation. So I don't know how common this is, but it certainly was a concern, you know, among surgeons. And it's, I think they even included in the, you know, the doctors are sort of trained to sort of look out for these kinds of disorders and things like that. So,
and this is part of what added to anti-pornography as well, so that wouldn't happen.
Right, they were worried about, these, you know, this sort of, though sort of foggy about the connections between all of these things, right, there was this sort of sense that this was a dangerous thing.
Yeah. I actually have a question for Judy along these lines. You said the law was passed in 1865. Mm. Any sense of why it took 4 years of war until they finally got around to passing it?
That's a good question. You know, it's
it took Comstock, didn't it?
And then it's really not. And then when it's passed in 65, it's really nobody's, you know, a few people are arrested under it.
Right.
It really does nothing until, you know, until it becomes the Comstock laws.
Hmm. Yeah, when he gets behind it. We'll get to him in a little bit
as
well.
That's when it comes. That's really when it becomes.
I want to show, this is not an original. We'd like to show real artifacts, but we can't. But you provided us, Judy, with something from the Kinsey Institute, which is some nice pornography from the war. Period. I guess we'd say pornography. I'm not sure that's what this is.
The term is sort of post.
So here is old John Brown. It's going to be kind of difficult to see this, but I'm going to try to hold it steady. There's old John Brown. And then, what does it say down here?
His noble heart.
His noble heart.
A biography of John Brown.
Then it opens up and it says,
the place of his birth.
The place of his birth. And then it opens up further.
For the grand finale.
And says, how he was hung. We know it should be hanged, but nonetheless, this is the pun here. So here's a piece of pornography. You saw the real one in the Kinsey Institute.
I did, yes.
And this was more satirical, I think, than anything else.
Sure.
Against John Brown and more than... than not.
Oh, I wouldn't say, I didn't read it as against John Brown at all. I thought actually they were quite
celebratory.
The celebratory of John Brown. Okay. I mean, I think this was supposed to induce envy in people who saw, right, this. And maybe just sort of, you know, reflecting well on any man who marched into battle singing John Brown's Body. So, I mean, I think it's kind of an interesting mixture of bravado, male bravado, and sort of the opposite of guilt by association, but right, that they wanted that sort of association with John Brown to reflect on them. So
now, since we're in the CDV technology here, I'm going to show another one. This one is of Jeff Davis. So this is right at the end of the war. Mm-hmm. This would have come out, where of course he was captured and allegedly dressed up as in his wife's shift or dress, even though it really was an overcoat just to keep him warm. But nonetheless, they had a field day with this sort of thing. What does this say, first of all, about gender and how one feels about gender at the Civil War period? And I know, John, you have some things to say about Jeff Davis in here as well. Let's get you first.
Well, I think this is this reminds us that, you know, that that when they're making these comments, that, you know, that political speech is often very gendered, right? There's a way in which they you know, they can sort of comment on Jefferson Davis and by sort of making these gendered references to him as a woman. And it's all about, you know, some of the other images that come out about him are sort of tantamount to rape scenes. They show him mm-hmm. sort of undressed from the waist down or being undressed from the waist down and attacked by Union soldiers. So it was, you know, it was a way of discrediting the manhood of the Confederacy after Union victory.
Many of them show the soldiers taking their swords to lift up his skirt so that they can look under and see if it's really a man or if it's a woman.
Right.
And it's interesting, the Davis marriage was very troubled and went through rocky times before and during the war. After the war, when Davis was put in prison, he and Verena often wrote to each other about their dreams. And their dreams were usually pleasant dreams of visiting one another. And what I found in my research is that as far apart as they were and as difficult as those times were, and Davis got very little sleep during the first 4 months because they kept the lights on all the time at Fort Monroe. Soldiers were marching back and forth, and every 2 hours they would slam the gate that kept his cell locked. So he's getting no sleep. But in those few minutes of sleep that he gets, he's always dreaming of his wife, he's dreaming of his children. And for the Davises, this was a way for them to commune with one another and visit one another in a similar way to soldiers had done with their wives during the war itself.
Now you group your book around themes mm-hmm. as you go through. One of them, of course, is a major theme, is the dreams of each other, the home front and
right.
the battlefield, dreaming back and forth. We have a couple of photos, images from your book of
yeah.
lithographs of the soldier dreaming of home, and conversely, the wife dreaming of the soldier. Here is the soldier dreaming of home.
Yeah.
This was a very common
right.
theme, no?
Yeah, the first one was Courier Knives, and that image was actually drawn, this image here, was actually copied from an earlier British print that showed a soldier in Egypt. And in the background of the British one were pyramids. And you can see on the left-hand side, they kept the palm tree of the Egyptian image. But this was a common idea that was around since as long as there's been soldiers, I suppose. But it really started to come out around 1800. With a poem that became very popular, and then in the 1850s it started to appear in prints. And by the 1860s, Civil War Americans really grab onto this, and they take out the Scottish soldier in his kilt and they put in an American soldier in a blue uniform.
It must have been very difficult to wake up from one of those. I know that every once in a while I have a dream I wake up from.
Yeah.
I've seen a gorgeous Civil War collection.
Mm.
And then I wake up and it's gone. It's not
yeah.
fair. And I think they felt the same
That's
way.
That's right. Mm-hmm. They often had very pleasant dreams of home, and then when they would wake up in the morning, they would be angry to realize that it had all just been a dream. And the sadness wasn't in the dream. The sadness was in the waking. I found one New York soldier who woke up from a pleasant dream of his wife. He wrote to her about it and said, "I was so angry that I went into Baltimore and got drunk."
We have another one to show of, let's see, it's The Mother Kisses Me, a song
yeah.
sheet. Or poetry
Mother
sheet.
Kissed Me in My Dream.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we have that's from your book as well.
Right.
And so that's also within the same purview of home and
yeah, this is a wonderful story.
Many of these
story.
Men were single, didn't have any wives. So
that's right.
Their mother took that place.
That's right. And in this one, the soldier that was killed at Antietam, and he had a dream that his mother came and visited him the night before the battle and kissed him, and he was killed. And he told this story, I guess, around right after he was shot. But this became a very popular song in the North. In fact, I found that at Gettysburg, there was one soldier in a regiment who sang this to his comrades to sort of pass the time and comfort them while they were in the midst of a battle.
Judy, let me ask you, the book that's been out so far, back in the 90s, was Thomas Lowry, The Story the Soldiers Wouldn't Tell, Sex in the Civil War. That used to be the standard source. Mm-hmm. Yours comes out of that. In a way, something you saw in there that was not produced. Is it still a valuable book for those who are interested in this subject?
Well, those people who are not familiar with the book, which I imagine a lot of your viewers are, it's a fine collection. And Lowry's, he has a good collection of many things. And one of the things he's collected over the years are images, and he certainly's gotten these court-martial records. He's got some material culture from the period as well. And the book, I think, his book collects those and presents those for readers. But he doesn't. He doesn't analyze them or sort of critically think about them within the context in which they were produced. And that's not what the book is about. The book is really, you know, sort of an entertaining. It's very entertaining book about these things that were produced for soldiers and by soldiers. But it doesn't link it with the sort of reaction to the materials.
Which is what you're interested in. Right. It's interesting, just to go back to that book for a moment, is that there was a wonderful chart that he had of all the brothels in Washington. And it was interesting because I'd say 80% of them were between the Executive Mansion and Congress. And here's Congress worried about pornography elsewhere, but
not on their front doorstep.
A little hypocrisy, but Congress and hypocrisy seem to go together.
Right. There's a timelessness to that. Yeah.
So it was a reaction. I think we have Comstock in a cartoon that was post-war, and that here it is, Your Honor. This woman gave birth to a naked child. So, making fun of Comstock, where did he come from that he was really the driving force that a law came for his, named after him?
Yeah, he is sort of the connecting link between these two stories. Comstock is Anthony Comstock. So, when his brother died as a result of his injuries at Gettysburg, Comstock takes his place and comes into the war late. And never really sort of feels accepted or part of the army and feels like an outsider. And he keeps a journal of his time in the army in which we sort of follow that feeling of being an outsider and being sort of offended by the men around him. And then some point in time he meets with somebody from the United States Christian Commission, and then is then sort of given a an interview with people from the YMCA, and
yeah,
in the aftermath,
they seem to be a part of that,
right? So in the aftermath, he finds, at least what I talk about in the book, is that he sort of finds his fight late. So his fight is one that he creates in the aftermath of the war, where he launches this highly successful campaign to eradicate pornography, or I should say it's very successful because it's that I think has bequeathed to us a lot of what we still have in place as sort of our moral image of ourselves. I think comes from Comstock. And he was very successful, not at preventing pornographic materials from circulating by any means, or really sort of controlling speech, although people were worried about that and concerned about that. But the Comstock laws stay in place and are quite successful at controlling women's access to information about birth control. Part of his campaign is to hunt down and to arrest and prosecute people who provide abortions and who provide medical care for women. And about that, he was very successful.
And you're also stating in here that it's also part of sustaining gender hierarchy. Mm-hmm. Now, when I first came into the business in 1971, the Civil War Roundtable began in our shop, the whole movement. Mm-hmm. And the Civil War Roundtable here in Chicago was, like many others, all male. So their wives, who we all knew each other, of course, and the wives had their own subgroup that met while the main group was meeting. They called themselves camp followers. So eventually they went away because they came into our group. We allowed, quote unquote, women into our group. So gender hierarchy was part of this whole thing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I think so. I think it's interesting because for Comstock, he always saw this problem as something that really affected boys and young men, right? That that for him, the erotica or access to this stuff was really a problem for men. Yet, on the other hand, with, you know, with his position in the postal, you know, in, as sort of chief policeman of the postal service, he was much more successful at controlling what women read and what women had access to, ultimately, in the end.
You know, I hate to have my stories blown up in my face, but here we have Abraham Lincoln having a dream of his own death,
right,
while he wakes up in the White House and comes down to all these this wailing and screaming, and he finds that the president has died. And that's not true. It's fabrication.
Right.
Oh, that hurts. That was a good story. Yeah. Tell us about this and how that came about.
Sure. Well, there's a couple dreams that are attributed to Lincoln of his own assassination. I think one of the most famous ones is depicted at the very beginning of the Spielberg movie. And in this dream, Lincoln was on a boat heading towards some unknown shore. And that dream comes down to us from several different sources. Lincoln reportedly had the dream before several major battles, before Gettysburg, before Vicksburg, before Bull Run. He told that dream, though, to his cabinet on April 14th, 1865. So it's the morning of when he'll be shot. They're waiting for Secretary of War Stanton to show up. Lincoln's just regaling them with stories, tells them about this dream. And after Lincoln is shot, four people who were in the audience or in the room that day then went and recorded it or told it to others. So that dream, I think, is true, that Lincoln really had this dream. Lincoln believed it meant something great would happen soon. He hoped it had to do with Sherman's army, but then people interpreted it after the fact of what would happen would be his assassination. Now, there's another story that comes down to us, and it's also very widely told, and it's the one you described, that Lincoln's in the White House. He's having a dream where he walks through the White House. He hears all this weeping and wailing and crying, but no one is around. He finally makes his way down to the East Room, and there he sees a catafalque with a coffin, and it's guarded by soldiers. And he goes up to one of the soldiers, and he says, "Who is dead in the White House?" And the soldier says, "The president. He's been shot by an assassin." And at that point, there's this great burst of grief, and now Lincoln can see all of the mourners in the White House. And it's a great story. And it gets repeated in many major histories. Many Lincoln scholars have told this story in their books. I even found in my research, if you remember the old show Touched by an Angel from the 80s, mm-hmm. Touched by an Angel did an entire episode where this was sort of the central theme, this story of Lincoln's White House funeral dream. And one of the beauties of writing history in this day and age is all the digitization that's being done. And so I started going on Google Books, and I started going on newspaper databases. Now, the main source for this story is Ward Hill Lamon, Lincoln's bodyguard. And Lamon wrote memoirs that his daughter ended up publishing in the 1890s. And everyone who cites this dream cites Lamon. So what I started doing was taking phrases out of Lamon's story and searching for them in other places. And I found a literary magazine in 1880 published a version of this story very similar to Lamon's, but without Lamon in it. And I kept searching, and I ultimately found two newspapers from 1874 that published very short versions of this story. And what I think happened was someone, we'll never know who, published this short version of the story in a newspaper. And someone read it later and thought, this is a really good story. And so they wrote a longer literary version of it. And then I think Lamon read it and thought, this is a really good story. I should be in it. And I think Lamon inserted himself into it. He published it as an article in a Chicago newspaper in 1887. And then his daughter took that and put it into the memoirs in 1893. That's where it comes from. And I've kept searching. I haven't found anything earlier than the 1874 newspaper account. I doubt I'll find anything that ever has an attribution on it from that period, because most newspaper articles had no byline. But I think ultimately it was something that someone made up, and then it's evolved into this story of Lincoln foreseeing his death.
Okay.
I was, to be honest, I was hoping you had the original manuscript here that then I could.
It's drying in the back.
That's right.
Exactly. Now, you speak about pornography being a bonding between officers, between men, and in what way was that a bond for them out there in the field and camp?
So there's a way in which it gave them a common language that they could speak with and communicate with. And we can see it in some of these court martial records that I use in the book, where they'll refer to a body song or a poem. And then another officer will say, well, or another soldier will say, well, I don't remember which one you're talking about. And then somebody else sort of, pipes up. So these were obviously things that were widely circulated and widely repeated, and people knew them, they had access to them. So they were part of sort of the language of mid-century manhood that certainly didn't create concern among these men, but then sort of in the aftermath created a concern among lawmakers. So, and there was a way in which this allowed soldiers, at least from the evidence that I found, allowed soldiers to sort of, from different parts of the country, different classes and different regions to share something when they were at the front. And I think one of the reasons why we haven't looked at, this hasn't been studied so carefully, is because I think we sort of think about when we want to look for evidence of soldiers' sexual lives, we want to find women in the camps. But of course, there are no women in the camps, or there are few women in the camps. There are women in the camp. There are few women in the camps. But there are these stories that they told about women, and there are the images that they told about women, or the ones they hung up in winter quarters. And those allowed them to sort of feel connected to home as well. But I also think it's important for us to think about the ways in which that sort of accentuated the fact that they were living in a male world. This was a world of only men. So I think we have a lot more to learn about the way they interacted with each other, and I think about the language of mid-19th century erotica that allowed them to interact with each other.
You also write, though, that it was used as an offensive weapon sometimes.
It
Colonel
could be.
Pierce was a good example of that, yes?
Sure, sure. So certainly a soldier, somebody who turned out to be, in Pierce's case, a bad officer, right, could get in trouble for his willingness to share in sort of telling the erotic jokes and singing the body songs if he broke other rules, right? Or if his men ceased to respect him, then they wouldn't have a problem sort of marshaling this stuff to get rid of him. But not because of the stuff, but because they didn't really like him and because he didn't turn out to be sort of the officer that they wanted. So yes, the stuff could bring men together and it could paper over some of the differences that separated them. But if a man turned out to be a bad soldier, a bad officer, then it could definitely be weaponized.
It's an interesting thought you have in here about the abolitionists and how their language and what they were doing morphed into the sexual mores, or at least the anti-porn as well. How did that happen?
So mid-century abolitionists were sometimes painfully aware of how, in order to sort of induce the kind of emotional reaction that they wanted in readers, to be shocked at and to be offended by slavery, that they had to tap into the same sorts of feelings that mid-century erotica dealers did, and I think they played both sides of it. They could be shocked and outraged at what what mid-century erotica dealers were selling. At the same time, they unconsciously or consciously built some of the same sorts of metaphors, the same sorts of language into their condemnations of slavery. So we have language of vampires, right, who were supposed to be sort of these voraciously, consuming people who were, slave owners were portrayed as vampires. Mm-hmm. But the vampires were also showed up a lot in mid-century erotica. They were people who were sort of sexually insatiable. And so there's a way in which these two genres borrowed from each other, even though mid-century abolitionists were on the surface outraged by that
so
comparison.
Abraham Lincoln vampire hunter makes sense.
Makes sense.
Absolutely.
In the context of the time.
Absolutely. Just
I'd like to put up the amalgamation waltz print How does this fit into the story that you're telling us about the abolitionists and pornography as well, for that matter?
Right. So this is a part of a series of prints that were produced that were critical of, you know, that were intended to criticize what abolitionists stood for, the sort of willy-nilly mixing of the races that was portrayed as deeply sexual, at least in this print and in some of the others of these series as well. So this is actually coming at it from the other side. These were, you know, anti-abolitionists, people who sought to criticize abolitionism, portrayed this, you know, this sort of horrible outcome of what abolitionists were trying to do, which would bring together, which would bring together the races in these promiscuous settings, and then ultimately this would be the result. So this is, you know, this is from the outside looking in at abolition.
Mm, okay. Going back to dreams, and this is, to me, you know, all encompassing, all of these go together to me. It was interesting how you spoke about sleep deprivation and how that impacted dreams and made it much more vivid. And of course, that's something that was in both armies, probably.
Sure. Yeah, there was incredible sleep deprivation in both armies, and not only during the campaign, but at any time. I looked at several men who were court-martialed for falling asleep on their post, and these were men in the Western territories. But even there, they were facing so much sleep deprivation that they couldn't stay awake at the times they needed to. And what modern scholarship shows in sleep studies is that when you are sleep deprived, your dreams will be much more vivid. And I think that helps explain why soldiers were having the dreams they were having and writing about them being so impactful, so meaningful, because they were so much more vivid as a result of being tired.
Excuse me. Another chapter you have here on slave dreams, which, interestingly enough, I didn't know this, interesting that their white masters were having some of the same dreams.
That's right.
Well, yeah. Tell us about slave dreams and how that connected too.
Yeah, so most of the book focuses explicitly on the 4 years of the Civil War. But for the chapter on African Americans, I needed to go broader, in large part because I just couldn't find enough material from the war years themselves. I also had to move beyond manuscript records and use published sources as well. So I used a lot of slave narratives, and you find all sorts of different patterns and themes that emerge in these narratives. In some cases, they dream of escape. In some cases, slaves wrote about escaping, and then after they're free, the dreams of being back and being captured and sent back into slavery. A number of slaves describe dreams of their family, because family separation, which Judy is doing a wonderful project on now, was of course one of the worst aspects of slavery. Children being sold away from their parents, husbands and wives being separated. And so you find slaves having dreams about the family that they've lost. Now, and then the second part of your question had to do with sort of the dream culture. And this was one of the most interesting things I found in my research, because for African Americans in the 19th century, dreams played a very important role in religious interaction with one another and conversion experiences. If you had a dream that sort of showed a conversion experience, that confirmed it for your community that you now were a Christian. And many whites looked down on that in the 19th century. By the time the Civil War came around, white religion was democratized, but they also wanted it to be respectable. So they looked down on African Americans for having these sort of primitive or superstitious dream practices. And one of the things I found in my research is that going back in time, whites and blacks had similar practices earlier in the South. And so by the time the Civil War comes around, they have different public dream practices. For whites, it's mainly reporting dreams in their letters and diaries. For African Americans, it's often more public profession of dreams. But they still have a lot of the same meanings, a lot of the same religious overtones. And so you see even people like Alexander Stevens, the vice president of the Confederacy, has the same kind of sort of what we now might call superstitious dream beliefs. What do his dreams mean? What do the symbols mean? You find slaves describing the same exact dream symbols. And so you can tell that somewhere in the history of the South, whites and blacks had commingled their beliefs about what symbols and dreams meant.
Harriet Tubman makes an appearance in your book. How does she get involved in this?
She does. Well, Tubman had suffered a head wound when she was younger, and that is believed to have had effects on how she slept and also the dreams that she had. And Tubman had incredible dreams. Of some were terrifying, some were hopeful. She had dreams of, I think they were serpents, and they had different heads on the serpents. And then she later met John Brown's sons and realized that the dreams had been of John Brown and his family. She had dreams of flying, which was a very common type of dream for slaves to have. And in one case, around 1860, she had a dream that she said, my people will be free. And she was at the home of Henry Highland Garnett when she had that dream. And he said, oh, Harriet, it's not going to happen. Stop telling me about this. But she kept insisting. She had a dream that slavery would be brought to an end. And then within 5 years, it was.
So other people must be keeping the record of those dreams for her. So
yeah,
right?
Those ones come out in the 1869 biography by Sarah Bradford, who knew Tubman up in New York and wrote the biography after extensive interviews with her.
So now I know when I was a teenager, I had flying dreams. And now I know why, because mm-hmm. my people were once slaves in Egypt. Mm. So
right.
slave culture
right.
came
right.
up all the way
I
down.
Was thinking also maybe teen angst. Right? I mean, don't all teenagers
right.
want
right.
to have
so
flying
that.
Dreams,
Probably
maybe?
Probably that. You're right. John in Atlanta, thank you for this question, an excellent question. Stephen Barry produced an edited collection called Weirding the War a few years ago, a book that calls for exploring the margins of the Civil War. Do you feel your books are in that genre? And how do you think the study of the margins of the war is progressing? Good question. Thank you, John.
Good question. That's a great collection. I love that collection. Mm-hmm. So thank you, John, for asking that question. I think that collection has a lot of promise for historians of the war period to explore underexplored topics. I also think that what makes Steve's collection so strong is because I think it's also really good social history, mm-hmm. right? I mean. Maybe we don't call it that anymore. Maybe
right.
that's kind of not fashionable anymore to talk about social history. But I thought, as I read that collection, that those essays represent some really good new social history that's been done on the war.
Right. Barry also, in his book All That Makes a Man, discusses dreams in a few instances. And in that collection, there's an essay on amputees, and I think it's called something like The Men Who Lost Their Arms and the Women Who Tried to Love Them mm-hmm. or something by Brian Craig Miller. Mm-hmm. And he opens with a dream that I poached and put into my book. It's an incredible dream where this woman named Emma Crutcher was a Mississippian, and she had a dream of her husband, and she wrote to him about the maximized joy that this dream gave her. And she dreamt that her husband went into battle and lost an arm, and she was overjoyed by this. And she wrote to her husband and said, because now I knew that no one else would ever have you. You'd be no use for the army, so you'd have to come home and be with me. And
right.
you wonder about the dynamics of that marriage.
Right.
In terms of weirding the war, on the one hand, I think that writing about dreams certainly as a genre fits into that. On the other hand, one of the things I try to do in my book is push back a little bit against what's sometimes called the dark turn in Civil War studies, where historians now are often focusing on the negative aspects of the war, the psychological and emotional damage that soldiers endured, the distance that emerged between husbands and wives through the hardening process that soldiers experienced. And so while on the one hand I have what might be considered a weird topic, on the other hand I'm pushing back a little bit and saying that for soldiers, their dream life was not entirely terrifying. It wasn't all nightmares of battle. I have a lot of nightmares of battle in the book, and for that I commend it to you. But that's part of it, and far more common were dreams of home.
Mm-hmm. So,
well, and I think that, you know, I think as far as this, as far as the erotica that was widely circulated in camps, I don't think that anybody, at least you know the people who I found talking about this, thought that this was anything other than just sort of part of who they were as men. Mm. I wouldn't think that they would be that they thought of it as sort of separate from or somehow you know, prevented them from doing their jobs as soldiers. So I don't know that they certainly thought it of it as marginal or from the outside, but we certainly have kept it separated from our history of the war.
I was just thinking about football teams, and many times the coaches have stopped their charges from the players from having sex the few days prior to a game because it would take away, but probably not.
Yeah.
What is Civil War studies like? Let's continue on with John for a moment. Mm-hmm. How do you two view Civil War studies today and where it's going, and is it where it's pushing the margins the most, et cetera? Mm-hmm.
I think we're at a really exciting moment in time to be in this field and to do the work that we do. I think there's a way in which one of the most exciting things I think about studying the war now is that is what now counts as Civil War history is much broader than I think it ever has. You know, there's this sort of artificial separation between people who do African American history, right, or people who do women's history, and then the Civil War, and those things were all sort of, you know, in their own separate silos. Even, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, those things were still sort of siloed, and I don't think, I think it's still the case that, you know, that you have some of that sort of feeling of like what counts as Civil War is not this, but I think those. You know, that the sort of borders between those are getting finer and getting blurry, and I think that makes it very exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One thing Judy and I were talking about earlier is one thing I'm looking forward to seeing more of is people challenging sort of the preconceived notions of the war, and especially things involving numbers. We oftentimes with numbers just think, well, it's got to be true if it's a number because it can't be changed. And yet, you look at the scholarship recently, the death toll of the Civil War has been changed, moved from 620,000 to somewhere around 750,000. In one of my earlier books, I tried to question what did it mean that 78% of the soldiers who voted in 1864 voted for Lincoln, and I tried to push back on what that meant. Thinking about reenlistment numbers, scholars differ widely on just how many soldiers reenlisted, or thinking about civilian deaths. The number thrown out there right now is that 50,000 civilians died during the Civil War, but there's no evidence for that.
No, and it's not footnoted or anything. It's just an estimate.
But it's been repeated enough that people just say, well, 50,000 civilians died during the Civil War. And so I would love for scholars, and part of the temptation for us as historians and as teachers is that when you have a good number, you can really make a lot out of it when you're talking to an audience or when you're teaching students. But I think we need to start questioning some of the numbers that we just take as being true.
And we're in a good position to do that because we have such great digital tools at our disposal now.
That's
we can have the students, we can present one of these, you know, these numbers that we've held onto for dear life for so many years and say, okay, now take it and run with it. Find out if it's true, find out why.
I remember reading something, and I should have fact-checked this before bringing it up, I suppose, but there had apparently been an article a number of years ago by a scholar who said that the idea of Irish need not apply was just a myth. And then a high school student, I think it was, went on digitized newspapers and found tons of instances of Irish need not apply. And so you had a high school student debunking a college professor who thought he was debunking a myth.
Fantastic.
And so this sort of, the resources that are available really democratizes knowledge. And who can figure what out and what questions we can ask and then answer.
Well, two fascinating books, two fascinating authors. I thank you both for being here and for North Carolina Press sending you here because they've always supported us and we are appreciative of that.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you.
Well,
thank
upcoming you. On Author's Voice, on Stranger Than Fiction, is Greer McAllister with Girl in Disguise. It's Thursday, April 13th at 3 p.m. If you're doing something like working and you can't watch, go into a closet maybe with your iPad and watch for a little bit. Or that evening or the next day or so, you can watch it on the archive. So April 13th, Girl in Disguise, Stranger Than Fiction. I think you're going to like that particular new show that we have on Author's Voice. On House Divided, we're coming back April 15th at noon. It's a Saturday, just like this. Brian Dirk will be here with Lincoln in Indiana as part of the concise Lincoln Library from Indiana University. Am I right? SIU. Sorry about that, SIU. I know that. Indiana was where I was and where we were just talking. So Jody Cantor will also be on the show with a fascinating book, Presidential Libraries as Performance. And she's made a very good case about how this is and what it really means. And that's going to be April 15th at noon, so next House Divided. I might also say that on April 21st, if you have kids, grandkids, Lady Bird and Friends, our children's and YA author's show, is going to have B.T. Gottfried on, The Nerdy and the Dirty. And I think your parents and if you're grandparents, you might want to look at this for your grandkids. It might be a good book for them as well. So please go to authorsvoice.net, and which you're on right now, and look over on our homepage and see what else is coming up and when. So again, Judith, Jonathan, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
We appreciate the staff for producing this show. I think we've made some very good shows from 11 years ago where we had one camera and got up there nervously and continued this going. But now I think our staff has produced a spectacular show that you're all going to enjoy. Tell your friends, sign them up with their emails here at Author's Voice, authorsvoice.net, and we hope to see you again very soon. Thanks for joining us.